Another thing to think, I've never talked about this again, it's something I've been pondering upon. Say, for instance, someone recommends a probiotic tablet, and there's some good ones out there. I think VSL3, there's some good ones on the market there that are beneficial. But think about it this is going to challenge you a little bit, so bear with me. So if you take a capsule that's got 100 billion organisms, it sounds like a big number, right? Does it sound big? 100 billion, that's a lot. But think about the biome. The biome is 100 trillion cells. They've already got these gangs and cliques formed in there. There's 7 tennis courts of surface area in the gut. So that 100 billion has to then compete with 100 trillion, so billion has to compete with 100 trillion, which is 0.001%. So for every one probiotic bacteria, we'll have to compete with 100,000 of existing bacterial cells. So think about that next time. And what science is telling us is that fermented foods, anything probiotic, are mostly transient. Like even if my stool samples that I look at, if people are having lots of probiotics and things like that, it doesn't necessarily show up in the stool samples. But the benefits are when you continuously have things like fermented foods, assuming that you've got a healthy gut, you're going to get the benefits from them, but then they'll pass through. So the important thing, and Greg will tell you in a sec as well, I'll get him up, but constantly consuming fermented foods is how you maintain a healthy gut. So you're not thinking it's a magical pill, you take the pill, it fixes you. It's really a lifestyle change to adopt this fermentation lifestyle, which has been with us for thousands of years as part of our culture. These lab-made artificial starter cultures, there's some good ones out there. Things that are well studied would be Lactobacillus GG, which has lots of benefits, Bifidobacterium longum, Akkermansia, which I mentioned before. Scientists are working on actually putting that in a pill. So that's hugely beneficial. But the simplest way to boost Akkermansia is fasting or 5-2 diet, because Akkermansia feeds off mucin. So if you starve the gut, or you starve, there's no food in there, Akkermansia has a selective advantage. And that's one you definitely want in your stool sample. Hugely beneficial. Fermented foods. I'm sure this is, the hero of the show. So let's touch on fermented foods. Any questions before I move on?
How long would you fast for?
5-2, I recommend. So
I reckon. You couldn't do something like 12 hours a day.
Ah, I see. I mean, the length of 16 hours. Mm, 16 hours is a good number.
Thank you.
So it's actually quite easy to fast because if you count the sleeping time, if you skip breakfast, have lunch at 12:01. That's a fast. I learned about kefir pretty much from the gut book when she talked about kefir. And then I started to research kefir and understanding where did this mysterious, magical food actually come from. And from my studies, I believe initially it came from the Mongols. Because what the Mongols used to do is, obviously they were conquering a lot, huge chunks of the world during, I think, the 12th century, I think, or so. And they used to travel with these huge hordes of horses and use mare's milk. And the way kefir formed is it was almost a spontaneous culture that just magically a group of bacteria, they got together, they liked each other and decided to stick with each other. And it's what we call a biofilm. And the body has biofilms as well. So they're what we call gangs that stick together. And kefir is a classic example of one of these gangs. There's two types. I'll pass milk on this side and water on this side. So we'll cover milk first. So it came from the Mongols. How it got into, I guess, the modern world was pretty much through the 16th century France, where there was a Jewish doctor. The king was sick. He brought like 100 sheep, was making milk, this kefir out of sheep's milk, and managed to cure the king. Then in 1907, a guy by the name of Eli Metchnikoff started to do research on Bulgarian centurions. Like, how are these people in this tribes living so long? And what he found was because there was the lactobacilli in the fermented yogurts and stuff that they were using at the time. Does that make sense? So milk kefir. How do we, firstly, let's talk about what's the benefits. It's very rich in probiotics. Depending on what study you look at, there's between 30 and 100 strains of organisms in there. All symbiotic, combination of yeast and bacteria. The key species in there is lactobacilli. Very, very, very important peace-keeping bacteria for the body.
I have none.
No lactobacilli. Well, you did the stool test. Wowzers. Sheesh.
Probiotic, like, is that going to be, would that have replenished it, or?
It would help. Yeah. I mean, kefir is going to be, it's far cheaper. Yeah. You make your own kefir, and it's so potent. Mm. So,
would it be more recognised by the body, wouldn't it?
Well? And food, that's a very excellent point there, because your body talks the language of food. Mm. Your body gets food. You've been having food for millions of years. You need food to thrive. And when you put like this one species in and then hope that they can conquer 100 trillion cells, and these things are going to be fighting against it. They produce their own antibiotics. It's not a pretty place, the gut. There's warfare going on. They produce antibiotics. They're eating each other. I've got actually, I posted footage of some microscope information with bacteria eating other bacteria. So it's a nasty world out there. So what you want to do is maximize food sources of probiotics, and that's why I love fermented foods. So very rich in probiotics. Michael Mosley will say it's around 50 strains in kefir. So that's a good happy medium to say it's around 50 strains. Boost the immune system. A lot of people in our community or people that come and buy products are oncology people, cancers. They're using it as a form of treatment. Antidepressant, it's detoxifying. Anti-inflammatory, treatment of IBS, bloating, gut issues, treatment of allergies and asthma. I use it myself. I have a pollen allergy. And when I feel it coming on, I dose up heavily with water kefir and milk kefir as well. And what kefir does, it has the ability to actually dial back the immune system. So you can just turn it down. And a lot of these allergies are because of this overactive immune system. So what they can do is like just turn down the dial a little bit because the body's got a little bit too excited. So that's the power of kefir.
What's the main difference between the milk and the water one?
Yep. That's a good question. I was about to go there, but thank you for reminding me. So milk kefir and water kefir are very different. So milk kefir is from the kind of, I guess, Eurasian area, you know, between Asia and Europe, Turkey. It's all a huge part of those cultures when the Mongols were invaded. But water kefir, we're really unsure where it came from. It's a very different species. It's probably around 15 or so strains in there, so it's not as potent in terms of the number of strains, but there's different ones in there. Remember how I was saying gut diversity is most important, to give it lots of different strains. And water kefir, I think it's either from China or Mexico. Uh-huh. And it's the same story where it's a biofilm, meaning that you'll see those little bits. Mm-hmm. What happens is a group of bacteria got together in a very rich mineral environment, like a spring, some form of water, a very heavy water. And these bacteria, and we'll see it now, they really like heavy water, lots of mineral content. And they form this biofilm, and they've people start to cultivate it. Maybe they thought it was a gift from the gods, and they start to use it in the ancient cultures. And then it's, you know, it's used in Mexico and also parts of Asia. So the message is, do both. Diversity is key.
So even if it's not like, because if you're lactose intolerant, is the milk, is that a problem, or is it, can you use milk?
Well, if you're lactose intolerant, firstly, milk kefir, I'm lactose intolerant. I can have milk kefir. The reason why I can have it is because I can, it pre-digests the lactose, because it's converting lactose into lactic acid. So then my body can tolerate it, because I don't need to digest lactose, it's done it for me, perfectly fine. But I understand if someone is a vegan, then, or they have an adversity towards, you love animals, having milk, or you can use, you know, you could use coconut milks, so I'll demonstrate in a second. You could use nut milks, cashew milks, or you can do water kefir. So there's heaps of options for people, you know, with different beliefs or different dietary regimes.
Does that change the strain if you use a different milk?
It does. It does. Because again, whatever food you put in there, you'll get a prevalence of certain types of bacteria. So obviously the medium for it is milk. So you can get more lactobacilli strains if you use milk. If you use coconut milk, it'll be a slightly different balance of different bacteria.
But then again, originally they would have used milk straight from the animal, wouldn't they? So
yes.
They would have been high fat, just like that.
Yes.
That's illegal in Australia.
Yes, yes. That's an excellent point. Excellent point. I mean, the Mongols...
Yeah, that's right.
So the Mongols would use the milk straight from the horse or sheep or goats. And we see this as when we're making kefir, my mum will tell you as well, we actually add cream in our production. It's because it likes the full fat, because these are how these things have evolved. So we're giving them, firstly, water kefir, very high mineral environment, because that's how they've evolved. And milk kefir, giving them a very fat-rich environment, because that's what they want.
Right.
But raw milk we can't get anymore.
Yeah,
because it's been outlawed in Victoria. So yeah. we got to use what we have. We got a Tassie or up north somewhere, you might be able to get it, or you can get goat's milk as well, raw. It's
okay.
Your choice. So let's do, is that clear? Any other questions before I demonstrate? Cool.
I think it's important to say that in the raw milk there's all the enzymes, and it's not just the fat that are important.
Totally. Totally, because it's a live food.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's got its natural flora as well before you pasteurize it. So the pasteurization will kill a lot of bacteria. The raw milk has the natural flora as well. But unfortunately, it's not an option for us, unfortunately. So let's demonstrate. Who wants to learn how to make milk kefir?
Yeah.
Very easy. So we have this product that we get from Slovenia. Amazing guys in Slovenia. And this is how easy it is to make milk kefir. Packet of milk grains. This grain, this one packet, should last you for the rest of your life.
Wow.
It keeps on growing. I mean, you literally, it is, sorry?
It's the best money spent.
It's the best money, because once you get this, this thing will continue to grow. It's like a pet. Think of it like taking a pet home, because you look after it. That's the other thing, is you have to look after it. It's not like you mix a powder in the packet and then put it in, you know, a jar and then buy a new packet each time. Once you get this, you have to nurture it. People sing to it and sing blessings because they're alive, you know. So, but the most important thing is to make sure that they're well fed. They're a pet. It's a live organism. They need food. They're a gracious pet, and they will look after you. You look after them. Give them lots of love. They'll give you bucket loads of love back for your family, and soon you'll be able to share with friends, and they might think you're crazy. You can gift grains, the gift from the gods, as they call it.